Okay. Please take your time, say hello in the chat so I know you are there, maybe where you're from. So I know if you're in a time zone like me or it's in the middle of the night. Okay. Good. It's a starting. Okay, let me turn the music off and turn the countdown off. So, good evening. This is Harold again from Hidden Room Studio here in Germany. On a Saturday night, it's 7:30 p.m. here in Germany. It's raining. It's raining all day for the last 2 days. And the land was, well, it needed the rain, so it was good we had rain. And I had to postpone the other live show I was planning for this Saturday about the MIDI plugins, because I had to prepare something and couldn't make it, so I changed it. Today I'm talking about mixing and especially about balancing your levels. So this is also Cubase only. I'm not, hey Reggie, how you doing? This is not about third-party plugins, whatever, and in the end I will show you a schedule, what I'm planning for my next videos and live streams. Okay, Jan Simons Nick 6 is there, okay. So in England is we're one hour ahead of England. Okay, let's go. Balancing your levels. Balancing is a part of mixing, is getting your levels right to each other. So let's see what I prepared here. First, I have to have some attribution here. For the sound examples here, I'm taking some multi-track recordings from Telefunken, or Telefunken, as we say in Germany. Telefunken U47 is, for example, a very famous microphone from the 50s or 60s. And Telefunken, it's a German company. I think it was Austrian and German. And that was bought then by an American company some years ago. And it's now Telefunken Elektroakustik. And they still write Elektroakustik, like you say in Germany. And they produce a lot of very, very good microphones in America, in the United States. And on their website, they have some multi-tracks. You can download the tracks. And I use two of that for example. One is Funky Dogs. It's a brass band, funky brass band, and Uncle Dead. I think it's Legend is the band called. It's a country song you will hear later. Okay, so thanks to Telefunken for the files. Let's move on. What is it today? Balancing your levels. I will talk a little bit about listening and referencing. Why it's important that you know what you do and that you listen a lot and you reference with the genre that you are mixing. No matter if you're mixing for other people, like when you have your own studio or producing your own stuff and mixing your own stuff. Then I talk a little bit about making decisions and why it's important to just move on and not to overthink too many things. Then about some genre typical balancing, it depends on what music you do. And then I go into the examples I have, the music examples. I will show you what you can do to make your balancing easier. One is using a spectrum analyzer. The next one is what's called the pink noise balancing. Maybe some of you heard about that or already used that or have seen some videos about that. And I give you 3 audio examples, full productions, so you see what I'm talking about. Or you hear what I'm talking about. The basics of balancing. Balancing means to get the levels of the individual tracks and instruments to each other right. That nothing is too loud, nothing is too soft. The important things are loud enough. And the problem is, if you're not experienced and you don't know the genre you are in or you didn't study it enough, it's a problem to know exactly where the bass has to be, where the vocals has to be, and what's important for the genre. And sometimes you end up everything louder than everything else. You just push it up and push it up and push it up and think, oh, okay, this has to be louder, the piano has to be louder, the vocal has to be louder, and then the other one is dropped, and then you put up the next one, and then everything is getting louder and louder. So referencing is important, I wrote. You might tell me, okay, I'm listening to this music all my life. I'm listening to metal, to EDM, to whatever, country music, all my life, I know what it should sound like. No, this is wrong. You don't know what it sounds like because you have to listen on your speakers in your studio and compare it to your production you do. So you just can't go blind. I mean, you can go blind if you know what you do and did it a long time, but reference is always key. And especially if you're working for other people, for clients, and they send you a production, send you their tracks, and they're in a genre you are not so familiar with. So you need some reference, ask a client for reference, put it in your DAW, and listen and compare how loud are the vocals, how loud is the bass. And you have to start with the loudest part of the track, with the most important instruments to make this sound good. And the most important instrument can be, for example, in electronic music, the kick drum. Or in the drop, the main synth. In pop music, it's the vocals. Also in country, it's vocals. In metal, it can be the kick drum or the drums plus the guitars can be the most important music instruments. So it's important that you start with the most important. Some other people, I mean, I start with the most important, other people start with the least important and build it gradually up and put it over the other and over the top. But in my opinion, then you have to be careful to have enough headroom to put at the end the vocals over the rest of the instruments and without having to turn everything down and not getting overloaded. So I normally start with the most important one. You can use a spectrum analyzer if you know how to. I show you some details and show you how tricks. The spectrum analyzer itself and all the measurements. This is a topic that can be used for a live show, for a 1 hour video itself. Maybe I do one. I'm only scratching the surface here. And for me, it's very important to always review my most important instruments. When I mix a beat, the most important instrument for me is the drums, is the kick drum and the snare. And whatever I do after some minutes or 15 minutes, 30 minutes, when I put in the other instruments, I take a step back, start from the top, just, I mean, I listen from the beginning of the song, and then I just listen to, is the most important instrument still loud enough? Can I still hear it? Or is too many of the other instruments over it and it's like clouded or like... it's drowned under all the other instruments. So always review the important things. Are they still loud enough? Because when you record some stuff, no matter if it's your own production, it's electronic music or if acoustic music, you tend to make the last thing you recorded too loud because you had the idea, hey, I need this synth, I need this effect. And you record it in the end. And then put it up because you want to hear it. And most of the time it's too loud. Then I wrote here, there is no static mix. Back in the day when we had the old analog board, the big analog board with 40 channels, a 24 track machine, and no automation, we were three guys, me and two guys from the band, sitting on the board, pushing faders. Each one had a list. For example, saying, guitar in the verse has to be 3 dB louder. So everyone had a list what to do, and so we were writing faders while we were recording the master tape. Today you have the automation, and there is no static mix. Sometimes when you have, for example, vocals, in the verse the vocals is softer than in the chorus, then you cannot make a static mix. There are some ways to address this. For example, you can automate your track, or what people nowadays do, and what I do a lot, is I copy the track, I copy the vocals to another track and cut it so that on one track is only my chorus vocals, on the other one is only my verse vocals. So I can process it individually from each other. That's why we end up with 60, 80 tracks. If you watch or if you read the Sound on Sound magazine, and they have some information about big mixers, how they work, and they have those printed out Pro Tools sheets. You see they end up with 60, 80 tracks because on some of the tracks you have only a snippet because it's easier to mix this one. It's easier to mix only a small snippet and you don't have to work with a lot of automation. Hello, Leonardo. I from UK. Please save it on your channel, he's saying in the chat. Yes, I will do. You can see it afterwards. Thank you for the good advice. Okay. So, and also try different applications. Some people start with balancing. Today, I'm only talking about balancing. But balancing for me means getting the levels right and getting the panorama right, the panning left and right. And don't be afraid in the first step to do it really hard, left, center, right. When the Beatles recorded in the old boards they had a switch, not a rotary knob. So you could only put it with the switch left, right, or center, nothing more. So do also panning. You can also go with balancing and EQing together. It depends, so try out what fits most your way of working. Then, how to work fast. Don't overthink the things. You will change it later anyway. You will change your mix, your balance later anyway. So don't overthink. Find a decent level for the most important instruments and take it there and adapt all the other channels to it. So that you have a basic static mix and go from there. And you can change it later anywhere. And you have this feature in Cubase now with a snapshot in the mixer. With a snapshot, you will lose your automation. But for the first balancing, you can use the snapshot to compare. And that's what I will do today. Don't forget the panning. When you get tracks from other people, if you're mixing for clients, ask them, after you imported the WAV files, ask them where is it seated, where what's left, what's right. I will show you later when I go to the brass band, to the funky DAWs. As I said before, always compare to this instrument, to the most important, can you still hear it? You will put things on top of each other and then you will see that it's overlapping, and the most important button for the mixer is not the solo button, it's the mute button, the mute button. If you see or if you hear that something is not loud enough or you can't hear it because it's overlapping with other sounds, then just mute some channels and watch for channels that are distracting each other. Don't solo one and go to equalizer and put in compressor on it or whatever. Just mute the other ones to see which ones are overlapping and what is disturbing. So remember, sometimes it's better to lower an instrument. As I said before, the last thing you recorded will be too loud. So sometimes when you said, I had the bass drum here, now I have the drop synth in, now I have the keyboard, the other keyboard in, and this keyboard, and now I don't hear the bass drum anymore, bring the other ones down. Don't bring the ones you don't hear up, the important ones. If you bring it up and then the next, and then you have to re-up, and then everything louder than everything else. Then you're pushing faders up and up and up. And in the end, on the third part, I will show you something, how you can make a balance, a rough balance in the beginning, so that all your faders are at the same level, unison. And I also explain why it's good to do that. And don't reach out for the compressor too soon. Go for automation. Use the automation if the verse and the chorus are from a different volume, or just copy it to another channel or to another track and mute or delete the things you don't need and process it individually. You might end up with 60 or more tracks. Doesn't matter. You can use it today in any DAW as much as you like, unless you have, like, I think Cubase Artist or Cubase Elements. I think has only 42 tracks you can use, or the entry level Pro Tools, that's free. The Pro Tools free is, I think, only 48 or so you can use. So what you do after this first balancing, first use the EQ to make your sound clearer. Don't, as I said before, don't grab for plugins first, but go to the EQ to make the sound clearer. Then review levels again, if everything is where you want it, and use the mute button to find clashing instruments. If you notice that, there is some part in the song where I can't hear the guitar, or there are three guitars playing and you can't hear the bass, or you can't hear the piano, find the one that is clashing. Okay. So now there is music. I don't want to talk too much today. You want to hear that? So I start with the music now. I start with a beat I made for, we're starting to make a beat store. It's called Sound One Beats. And I show you the mixed and the unmixed beat and show you some tricks with the analyzer, how you can do that. And then I show you the pink noise trick. Some of you might already know that or even tried it. With two full productions. One is Funky Dog's brass band. And funny enough, when I reviewed the tracks in the beginning, I noticed there is no bass. It's all on brass, and there's a sousaphone. I think there's a bass trumpet or something like that. It's bringing the bass. And then the third one is Legend. It's a country band. And this one I want to do like blind. I won't play the full production, the full song until the end. And we'll show you the difference between the unity gain and the one that I did, bringing all levels or all faders to the same, to zero, and then going from there. This is going to be exciting because I don't know what's ending it. I didn't prepare that. So just let's see what's happening. Okay, let's go to Cubase. So, okay, I hope this is loud enough. This is a beat I made for Sound One Beats, for the beat store we made, Reggie and me. We're going to put online, and this is only a few tracks I have here. And just let me play that for you, and then I will explain some tricks or some things I'm thinking about when putting up the level. And this is first is the full mixed version, the one that's I muted the tag here. I have that Sound One Beats, I tagged it, and I muted this so you'll get don't get annoyed of me saying soundonebeats.com. And first, let me just play a little moment of this. You already had that in the beginning. Okay, let me change to the analyzer. Okay. Okay, what is this about? The genre is electronic music, smooth hip-hop, melodic R&B, whatever you call it. So you should know your genre. And I used some beats from other people I bought and I have licensed to use as a reference. And there's one guy on the internet, his name is Zenworld. C-E-N or Z-E-N. And Zenworld as one word, and he's doing a lot of YouTube music, YouTube videos about EDM mixing and producing. And he also came up with this Voxango Span Analyzer, and I'm also using this to find my level. And okay, this is called Cubase only, and this from Voxango, this analyzer is free. You can download it on their site and use it. I have it in the master channel of the control room all the time, so I can use it. But if you don't want or cannot download this one, you can go to Cubase, and there is an insert, or there is in Steinberg, there's an equalizer called, where is that, Curve EQ? Let me see. It comes with Cubase. It's a curved EQ. Here, it looks like this. It looks almost the same, but it's a kind of matching EQ. So you can analyze, for example, I didn't try that up to now. It comes with Cubase, it's licensed in Cubase, and it has the same analyzer. And you can analyze, for example, a fixed finished production, and then can put the EQ over your own, so that sounds similar or has the same sound. So when I play it, let me go just play that. You see, you don't need the span I'm using. You also can use that curve EQ in Cubase itself as an analyzer. So what is the analyzer doing? It's showing the frequency distribution over the whole spectrum, starting from 20 hertz to 2k. So where do I aim? I aim with a kick drum in this kind of music to get about to be here at about -35, -40 dB. Hi Pankaj Rana from India. Nice to see you back. Okay, let's go here. Now let's solo the kick. So you see the kick is somewhere here. So it's about -42. This is just roughly between -40 and -35 to aim for the kick. The kick for me here is the most important one. And from there I build up my levels. And I can come back to that later when I talk about the pink noise. Normally you should mix your production so that all the frequencies are even. And in this case, you have the possibility to have a slope here. The slope is, I can show you, is a function that will lower or raise certain frequencies, because normally the ear tends to concentrate more on octaves than on the frequency itself. So between 50 hertz here and the next octave is the double frequency 100, is only 50 hertz different. From 1K, one octave higher, is 2K, it's 1000 hertz difference. And you should aim for getting a little roll off in the highs. That's what people are saying, that what people are doing for some years now. I had always trouble with that because I didn't know how to roll off. See, like this, a little roll off in the highs. To be like in pink noise. Pink noise is a noise that has all the frequencies over the spectrum in a way that the ear is used to. They, like as I said before, you can have about the analyzer a whole hour. And because I never know if it's here too steep or if I roll off good enough, I use that function for the, where is it, for the slope. It's on 4.5, and this function raises the frequencies so that it's not going down, but it's keeping all horizontal. So I aim here with this function for a frequency distribution that is horizontal over the whole spectrum. So if something is for the whole time getting way too high or way too low, then I can see in the analyzer that it's wrong. So I start normally with here the kick drum, put it here, and the next one that's important for me is the snare. So these are the two instruments I concentrate on, and these are the two instruments I start with, and I always all the time compare if I hear them loud enough. Okay, let's go to the next snare. We'll turn that off. Here we have the snare 2. It's like a clap. And then I have a clap also, and then I build it up. So, and we have the bass. Here you can see that's what I always trying here. That's what I was always comparing here. Where is my bass lying and where is my kick lying? Is the bass over the kick or under the frequency wise? You can see here the bass, the kick is about 45 hertz, and the bass is higher here, but it's louder than the kick because I wanted in this to be louder. And from there I built gradually up the whole song, and also compare all the time if there's not a hole or something too loud. In this case, this is a beat. This is a beat you want to sell to artists, to rappers or singers. And in this case, I leave a hole around 200 to 500, and normally I do that in the mastering. This is the mastered version. Let me see here, frequency. Normally I do that, oh no, it's not here. Normally I do that in the mastering, so I have room when somebody's putting his voice on it, that it will not get drowned under the music. So in this case, I will go back to the unmixed version and show you the first unmixed version. This is the version I had Okay. This is now the version I had before I started mixing. When I go to the final mix, in this genre, in electronic music, it's very popular that before you go to the mixing phase, you already fixed your sounds in any way, because you have your sounds from samples. And the good thing about the electronic music is that you have a steady volume. You will hear later in the other example with the real instruments that there is a big dynamic in the volume, and then you have to take care about that a lot. Okay, let me go here. Okay, let me just go here. Yeah, let me go here and just bring everything down so I can show you how I address this. So go here, sync bank, pad moving. Okay, as a main, what's on this? Okay. That should be okay. So, going to what part are we going to? Let's see. Take the first part just here. Press the P. When you press the P on your keyboard and you selected this, or select a part here and you press the P, you will have your locators here. So, when you have a here, press P and you will have the locators here. And from there, you can then cycle your music. So let's start. Go back. Start with a kick. And this one, I would go. Where's my analyzer? Let me get my analyzer. So this is to aim for somewhere about minus 40. Then I take the next one, so I'm roughly at the same. I can hear it's the same volume, and I can see it's the same here. The second snare, the clap. Oh, it's not cycling. Okay. I have a crash here. Okay, the crash here. The hi-hat. The second hi-hat. The other side. DJ here. An effect. Effect is coming here. Yes, this. Noise effect, and then move over to the long 808. Let me solo that so you hear it. And as long as I do this, I always control if the bass drum and the snare is loud enough, because having the snare 2 dB louder or softer can change your complete song also with the kick drum. So I want to have it in a certain range, and I always compare that. And in this stage where I'm now with all the percussive instruments, it's very easy because they're not overlapping too much. But when I come to like the bass, the pad, the arpeggiators and everything, it's overlapping and it's clashing with each other. So this now without the 808, with the 808. And again, I'm watching my analyzer to not go too high. And sometimes you come to the point where you say, I don't hear it loud enough. But you think everything is okay, but you don't hear it loud enough. Then turn your speakers up. Do not grab to your faders or to master fader in Cubase and turn this one up. Turn your speakers up. That's what they are for. So if you really want it pumping, if you really want it loud, turn your speakers up. Okay? So take the next one. This is the bass. So, somebody once said it's a good rule when you bring bass and kick together, then you get a raise in the level of 3 dB with a VU meter. I never tried this. I always compare it here with the analyzer, and that it's not pumping too much, not like this. Unless I want it to be like that. Okay, it's if the bass is the important instrument for me. It's now without, now with. Bring the bass in. And now the different part, the pads. This is not the important instrument, so if you bring this up too loud, it will be too loud and overlap all the other instruments. So don't bring up these instruments too loud. The next pad, here. Because this is only a pad, this is not the important instrument. You might like the sound very good, but this is not the important instrument. Oh, I have to turn down a little bit. The volume might be overloading a little bit. Yeah, I see it might be overloading a little bit in OBS. Bring the mix boost down a little bit, okay. So, then we have an ARP. So this is a more important instrument because it brings movement. So you can turn it up a little bit more. Then we have the lead two. This is the melody. So that should be most of it, right? This is most of it. And I got, I think, one lead line here left. And let's go to the another one here. Now you hit with a clap, with a second snare. The lead two, and I mute this, and I have the lead one. So, now I'm on the stage where I have everything in. And now it's about time to just relax, step back, and listen to, can I hear my kick and snare and my important things loud enough? If not, I have to turn the other ones down again. Don't turn them up. I mean, you can turn up a little bit, but turning up the bass or this or the snare a little bit, but make sure that you're not distracting all the other percussion instruments. So if you have the feeling that the not so important instruments are too loud, then turn them down a little bit. So just relax, take a step back and listen. What about my kick? Let me try a little bit more on the kick. So you hardly hear the pad that's underlying here, because this is one of the non-so-important instruments. So this is very crucial that you really check or decide, make decisions. What is my important instrument? How loud should it be? And reference it. Reference it to your tracks. In this case, I have still the reference track here in my Cubase, but I cannot play them for you, because I might get problems afterwards with YouTube with the content ID. And in this case, always check your levels and make decisions. And don't be afraid. If you think it's okay, then release it. Then, because your client or your fans will tell you later anyway if they like it or not, or if it's wrong or not. So if you're working for a client and you say, okay, I'll make a mix for a client, three revisions. Send you the first one, he will send you the corrections. The next one, corrections. He will tell you anyway, and sometimes you're totally wrong. It's all about communication. Sometimes when I mix things, for example, I mixed something for Reggie last time. It was all over the place because I was missing some tracks. It was weren't on the arrangement, and some was good. He said, well, great how you did that. Others were, I had the difference. When you have a rough mix, always compare it with a rough mix. So when you get a Cubase session like this, And the producer who sent you the session, and you have already a session here, and before you change anything, export it as a WAV file that's imported on a certain track, on an individual track, in your Cubase, in your arrangement. Then you can compare it to the rough mix anytime, because this is what the artist heard and what he wanted. So you make sure you're not getting too far away. Okay, so this with the analyzer is a tip. You just can use this one from Voxengo, the Span, or use the Curve EQ that has the same analyzer, or any other analyzer, because I really like to make sure that my levels are okay here, that my frequencies are right here, like that. Nothing is too much. Here in the middle, the lead is a little bit too much, I think. Yes, and if you have the feeling it's not loud enough, it's not exciting me, turn your speakers up. Here, grab to your volume on your amplifier, whatever, turn your speed up. Don't change it here. Don't, if you need a pumping bass kick drum, and you have a subwoofer, there's a rule about subwoofers. Subwoofers are always too loud. Professionals make their subwoofer too loud, and amateurs make their subwoofers way too loud. That's why you have to compare and analyze and reference. Okay, let's move on to another one. Let's make the pink noise trick. Okay, let's go here. Let's load up this one. So this is one from Telefunken. Telefunken Elektroakustik. It's a manufacturer of microphones, and to showcase the microphones, they invite people in their studio and record them, and you can download then these multi-tracks on their website. So this is a multi-track I downloaded on their website. It has a lot of percussion, drums, and horns, and vocals. So what we're going to do here is the so-called pink noise track. Pink noise is a noise where the frequencies are in octaves with the same energy, and is very pleasing and very used. The ear is very used to a frequency distribution like with pink noise. So the idea is to have a test generator here in Cubase that is generating the pink noise, and then you bring your levels up so that it's a little bit, each instrument in solo, that's a little bit over the pink noise to simulate how it would sound. When you have the complete mix, the frequency distribution would be like the pink noise. And if you have the one instrument a little bit over the pink noise, it's like simulating all the other instruments, no matter where they are, and the other instrument that you are leveling is a little bit above. So let me show you first. I have to make sure it's not too loud. The pink noise here. Okay. Okay. So what I aim for in this case is I don't want everything be too loud. So I'm using the pink noise in a level here at, this is in a digital scale. Let me take the K20 scale. This is the K20 scale that is not going to zero, but it has a zero here and 20 dB. Over that is what's the 20 dB full scale. And I'm aiming for here zero, and then I have enough headroom above that. What I do all the time is I bring all those horns and drums and whatever together in groups here, in subgroups. And you can see it also here. Where is it? Here we have the percussion group, the drum group, and the horn group, and the sax. And in this case, I'm going first to make the adjustments on the panning. The panning is now to center, to everything. And just go quick through all the just kicks. This is overhead, it's in stereo, okay, so no panning. Rack tom, I always like to have my toms like from the drummer's point of view, meaning the high toms are on the left side, the hi-hat is on the left side, the low toms and the stand tom is on the right side. So I'm taking this rack tom, this is on the tom, snare bottom. Okay, we have only rack toms. We have snare bottom and top. Then we have some percussion. I don't know what these percussions are doing. I just bring them a little bit to the sides just to make some room. Percussion overhead is here. I leave it like this. Then the next one are the horns. And there is no bass and there's no dedicated singer. All the horn players are singing. And I looked it up before. I think the trumpet here, these are the main singers. This is the one trumpet. One and trumpet two are the main singers. So I leave the trumpet and the vocals here in the middle. Their vocal trumpet. They have a microphone for the horn, a microphone for their voice. And put all the other ones to the sides. So to the trombone, left and right. And also the vocal of this guy, left and right. Then the saxophone, half left. And the second half, half right. I don't know how they were placed. And in this case, I don't care. This is just, I can change it anytime. And I have the sousaphone here. And I put this a little bit to the side. So like this. Then I go and in the mixer. Where's the mixer? What view do we have here? Like this view. Okay, in the mixer, we have the possibility here to make a snapshot. Then I take a snapshot. In this case now, everything is to zero here. Everything is to zero. And what I do now is turn everything down, turn on the white noise, solo each one. And then within three or four minutes, I push the fader up. So a little bit over the noise and then back that you can almost not hear it all. You can almost hear it. And I do that from channel to channel to channel to channel to simulate how it would sound this one instrument with everything together. And then let's see what happens. Okay, I have a snapshot here. Okay, I don't want to recall it. Okay, recall snapshot one. We have the snapshot one. Let me update that again. So this is the way it was before. Now go here. Everything down. So, and I use the subgroups, as you can see, like spacers. When you select a subgroup, you can select that you want sub to be with the faders here or at the end at the master fader. I like to have it here. So I have like drums here, percussion here, horns here, and everything. So you have it handy. Just as a spacer. And then we have the vocals here. And this is the mix bus, getting everything. So if I turn on now the pink noise, okay, it should be like this. I hope you can hear that. Let me check my level here. View bass. Okay, I turned this up a little bit so you can hear it better. Let me don't forget to turn it down later. And okay, let's solo this one. And then I go to a part where I have, let's see, where are they singing here in the beginning? They are singing here. Okay, I'll go here. And now I start with the floor tom here. Solo, floor tom. You hear the rack tom here? Now I turned it down a little bit. So that's this. Go to the next one. Kick. Now over the, now go back. You barely hear it. Okay. Next one. The kick outside microphone. Very low, the back, the overheads, turn it back so you barely hear it above the noise. So the rack tom, where is this? Okay, it's here, a little bit back. Okay, go to the snare. Button. This is the microphone under the snare. Okay. Snare top. the top. Okay, go to the next one, percussion. Okay, cowbell, percussion. Other side, next percussion. Go very fast, more from the gut, just don't overthink, so you can barely hear it. Another percussion here. And percussion overhead. Back. So now we come to the horns. We have no horns here. So we go to the vocals first. That's here. This one. Vocal here.
It's a place to be.
Place to be, okay.
It's a place to be.
I hope you can hear that. Take the next one.
We gonna rock this party like
the right side.
It's a place to be. It's a place to be. We gonna
rock a bit softer.
It's a place to be. We gonna rock this party like it's a place.
As you can see on the tracks, there are very much difference in the level. Next one. Okay, let's go back to one, the beginning. So I'm on the point where he's singing. So go here, next one. Now we come to the main.
We gonna rock this party like New
Orleans. A little bit softer. Okay, now we need the part where we have here horns. Okay, take this one first. Trombone. A little bit softer. Other trombone, other side. Sax. Second sax. Sousaphone is the bass. That's the trumpet. The second trumpet. So that should be it. Let's go here. Let me go back to the mixer and go here, the mix bus. Okay, let's turn that a little bit down so we don't. So let's listen. We have set up everything here. You see, everything is different. So let's go to the individual parts and see what we did. This is the first part. Let's go here and just listen. See if it's loud enough so you can hear it and not overloading. Make sure.
Okay. Because there ain't no party like a funky dog party. It's a place to be. It's a place to be. It's a place to be. We gon' rock this party like New Orleans. It's a place to be. It's a place to be. We gon' rock this party like New Orleans. It's a place to be. Oh, it's a place to be. We gon' rock this party like New Orleans. It's a place to be. It's a place to be. We gon' rock this party like New Orleans.
Okay, you can hear the vocals is not loud enough.
It's a place to be, because there ain't no party like a funky dog party. It's a place to be, it's a place to be, it's a place to be. We gon' rock this.
You can hear the drums good, you can hear the percussion good.
It's a place to be, we gon' rock this party.
Let's go to the part where we have the horns. Like this.
We gon' rock this party like
like New Orleans. It's the place to be. It's the place to be. We gon' rock this party.
Yeah, I can hear the sousaphone, the bass. Yes, this way you can have a fast, when you have a track you haven't heard before and you have no idea where everything should be, you can start like this. So you have a good basis to start. Some things are overlapping. I have a lot of percussion here, but this is the group itself, a lot of percussion players. And the sax players and the horn players are the vocalists. And you can see also here from the tracks, there is a lot of dynamics. And that's what I said before. In this case, there is no static mix. You now have to cut. You now have to go through all the tracks and watch for overlapping tracks and use, for example, the equalizer to make it a little bit clearer, the whole thing, and also, let's say, not the compressor, redo some volumes, like the main volumes of the vocals. Let's go just to the beginning. Okay, so you can hear from the beginning what they are doing. Okay, they're introducing them in the beginning. So let me go here.
It's a place to be.
I made a snapshot.
It's a place to be.
And now recall the first one.
It's a place to be.
So this is when everything is the same volume. So the drums are very much louder than what we had. Let's recall the one we did. So the vocals is clearer now, the drums not so loud, and the percussion is coming out more. Let's try this at the part with the horns. So this is the one we did. Here. Everything is louder. Well, that's not bad. So this all depends on how it is recorded. If it's recorded live, if it's recorded with all the same levels, if it's recorded like taking care of the levels before. And here you see the difference, and you should make, when you start with something like this, various maybe versions, and then use the snapshot and just go to the snapshot here, the new one, click, and then you have what we did, and then we go here to the horns. I think this is a little bit more even than when you have everything and the same level. If we have set everything in the same level. But having everything in the same level in unison, like we had before here in having everything on zero, is sometimes also a good idea. And I know people who did that. This is a story. This is from way, way long ago. A producer from the area here, he called me and he said he has his own studio. And he said the saxophone player is coming over in 2 days. And I want to record saxophone for my new song, but my engineer is not in town. Can you come over and record the saxophone for me? Because he was a producer and he wrote songs, but he wasn't an engineer. And he said, it takes only 1 or 2 hours and it's 50 or 60 kilometers from me. I said, yeah, sure, no problem. So I went there and the saxophone player came and he gave me the tape. I put the tape on the 24-track machine and asked him, how you want me to mix it? I had the sheet where all the tracks were, how you want me to mix it? And he said, oh, just bring everything in unison, in zero, and it will work fine. I said, okay. And I did. I put everything there and it was boom. The sound was there and it was really good and everything was, everything fit, all the instruments fit, and you had all the levels were the same. And I said, how you do that? And he said, I don't know, my engineer is doing that all the time. So I called the engineer when he was back in town and he said, yes, he's taking care of the level when he's recording and he's doing that with a trim. And he's doing that also when he's recording on tape. And so that when he takes the tape to any other studio, he doesn't have to care about where are my levels, just put everything in zero and it's done. It's like there. And this is what we try to achieve now with the next example. Okay, let me go over to this. It's a bigger one, even bigger, also from Telefunken. And it has a lot of drums here. And okay, it has a lot of drums, acoustic guitar, various guitars. And here you can see also different levels, louder, softer. And just what we do here is the same as we did before. I go here, I keep my levels here. And in this case, okay, this, I don't need that. I'm using here, I go to the racks and go pre-filter gain. And I'm using the pre-rack here. And here we have the gain. And I'm using now this to do the same as I did before with the pink noise to change the levels, but I use the pre-gain and I can use this gain to minus 40 or plus 40. So way more than this. And I leave these untouched. So let me first just go through that very fast. Hi-hat to the left. Then we have kick, 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 in, out, overhead, left and right. Okay. Room, ceiling, okay, room, room, left and right, okay. Have some room microphones. Drum room, snare, up and down, toms, one, okay, tom one, should be left. Keep the other one in the middle. Drum, fat head, millennia, this is the stand tom, go to the right, like I said before, going from left to right. Then going to the acoustic guitar. One and two, they recorded left and right in stereo. I keep them in, oh, I don't keep them in the middle. I go like, taking this one to the left, this acoustic guitar one, the other one to the right. Keep the third one in the middle. The banjo, half left. Here, like this. What is this? The bass in the middle. The dobro, we take right. So, the fiddle will stay in the middle and the mandolin can also go hard right. Then what do we have here is the piano. We take this in stereo, left and right. And we keep the background vocals, no, the lead vocals in the middle and the background vocals a little bit to the side. Those, that's it. And now we go to the mixer again. Make a snapshot of this. So I have the snapshot now. And what I'm going to do is I do the same as before. I adjust the levels here, up here on the gain. Then I will correct in my snapshots with a mix bus that here the levels is the same. And I'm not going to listen to this before, just only after I did it. And then we can compare it. Okay, the next mix bus is here. Okay, now we go to the... Where is it? My pink noise. Solo it here. Okay. I'm also going here to minus 20. I hope you can hear that. If not, I turn this up a little bit. So. Then I'm going to a part here. Let's take this part. Okay. Cycle it. Okay. Start with the hi-hat. Forgot I don't want to do this like here. I want to use this one here. Okay. The deep one. Minus 9. The other side also minus 9. Okay, the drum room. The other drum room. Other drum room, the snare, minus 5.8, so the tom, the dum, okay, the other tom, we can hear all the bleed here. Another tom. Okay. Turn this down a bit. The other side. Minus 9. One in the middle is almost there. Also almost there. The banjo. Minus 8.5. Okay. The bass. The dobro. Right side. Down a little bit here. Okay. The fiddle. Also down a little bit. Mandolin. That's it. Then we come to the piano. Minus 9.6. Then we go to the vocals, main vocals. Where is it? This is country, so the vocals can be a little bit louder. Second voice. So, that's it. That's it. So I put everything here. Okay. Okay, like this. You did it. So now I'm going to turn this down. Oh no, first I make a snapshot here. So let's see how this comes out. I take this down so you don't hear it and I don't hear it. Then I go to the beginning and then I play the whole thing and see where I am here. Okay. We're peaking about minor 3.0 somewhere here with this version. Yes, 2.4 and the mix bus. Now I go to my, snapshot 2. Okay, this was the last one we did before. Let's play this. Up. Not like this. Turn this down. Then go to, what it is? What is it? Minus. Is it minus 2 point? Okay, a little bit down here. Because louder is always better. Okay, minus 3 here. Okay, turn this off. Go to 0. Update snapshot 2. Okay. Let's go to snapshot 3. Record snapshot 3. Okay, that's the one I did before. Let me check that again. Okay, almost the same. Minus 3. Go to 0 here. And oops. And update snapshot 1. Okay. Let me check if I have it right here. Okay, maybe I record the first wrong one. Okay, let me check that again. Yes, should be okay. So now I have two versions, snapshot 1, snapshot 2. Now we can listen. Turn it down a little bit because this is with the whole tracks. It's very loud. So we first take the first snapshot. Oops. The snapshot 1 was the one without, no, the snapshot 2 was the one without changing here, without changing the gain. Only changed here the mix bus. Let's listen. And now I change to the one we did. You see, then the gain will change here. Well, I can hear the kick very good, the drums. So go back to the other one. So here you can hear with the one where everything is the same and nothing is changed. It's on the side, it's too loud. With the instruments are too loud and the drums are not kicking enough. And like I said before, this is country. So in country, you need the vocals a little bit louder. You can see there's nothing, the gain isn't zero in the vocals. And if I play this, the vocals will not be loud enough. Because all the instruments on the sides are too loud. Now go back to the one we did. Now you can hear the kick, the bass. Okay, still the vocals are a little bit too soft. But this is because here we have a lot of dynamic in the vocals. This is to illustrate another use or application of the pink noise or of having the levels. But keep in mind, if you do this, you should do this as the first step. Because when you change the gain here and you have already some inserts here like compressors, you also change the gain that's coming into the compressor, and that will change the way the compressor is behaving. So let me play that again. This is the last thing I have for today. And picture yourself, you work with some other people, you have also Cubase, like I'm doing with Reggie, and we put our arrangements in the Dropbox, and I open it from the Dropbox, and you send someone your arrangement. Everything here is at even level, is in unison here, and he's like, okay, how might that sound? And then he's got blown away by your sound, because it's like I was in the days with the analog tape, because I never thought that this could be possible. That I know that people like Bob Clear Mountain, for example, who was working with Brian Adams and U2 and a lot of big people, he said he doesn't like to have his meters or his faders all over the place. And he's working like this. That you can have, he can have a little bit of adjustment in the faders or with the volume automation, but when he starts, he has everything here and starts with the gain here. So let's compare this again. Listen to the drums. So let's go back to this one. Again, listen to the drums, and for the last time, I will go over then to the one we did. Listen to the drums, the bass, the snare, the instruments are loud. Now you have the kick and the snare and everything. So you have a good basis to start with. Maybe this is not your kind of music. Maybe this is totally not what you expected or what's interesting for you. But for those people who work for others, be free in your mind, no matter what arrangement they send you, no matter what song they send you, try to make it the best. And even if you're in electronic music all the time and somebody's sending you a country song, get some references, get to know in country the vocal is the most important, because country is about telling stories. This is the most important. If you are into, say, metal, black metal, whatever, where all those growl vocals are more a kind of instrument, a kind of sound design. You don't understand the words anyway, but you have to have a kick drum and good drums and good guitars. Then it's totally different. Okay, so I hope that was a little bit inspiring for you in EDM and in electronic music, where you have fixed levels. Because you're working with VST instruments and with samples all the time, it's a little bit easier, because you don't have to worry about the changes you have here in the dynamics. But you can use, for example, as a reference, the analyzer, or put in the analyzer, reference the songs that you like, put them in Cubase as an audio file, reference them, look at the analyzer, and listen good, listen exactly what's important, and go for that. So let's go back. Here we are. So we had mixed and unmixed beat with balancing with the analyzer and starting with the most important instrument. Then the pink noise trick for full productions, basic balancing and panning with the Funky Dogs brass band. And now the Unity gain fader setting. So you can impress your friends and people by sending them an arrangement. Everything is in Unity fader, but it still blows them away and everything is fine, because you know what you do. Okay, so summary. Try different options depending on the genre and production. Just learn and try things out. And if you're into live music and, say, with acoustic instruments, go to the Telefunken website, download the multi-tracks to practice. It's a good idea, or work for free for other people. Say, like my neighbor was coming over 3 years ago. He has a little rock band doing stuff like Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and he asked me to record him. So I recorded him with 12 microphones in his living room, everything. Just go for it, and you will get better and better and better. And one day it will be very easy, because you know what's important for your music. If you work for others, communicate, so you know what's the important instrument, because it's annoying when you have 3 revisions and you go over and over and get back all the time. Oh, this is not right. This is not right. Then find a basic approach that works for you and stick to it. You can experiment, but if it works, just stick to it and don't overthink your things. Your clients and your fans will tell you anyway if they like it or if it's right or wrong. I mean, hey, I like your new song, but I couldn't understand the words. Oh, the new song, it was really hot. We played it in the club, but the bass was too low. then you get the feedback anyway. Don't over if your own productions. Some people sometimes ask me, when is my song finished? And I tell them, it's finished when you release it and you have to make the decision. And mixing is about making decisions and not being unsure all the time. Ah, is it good enough? Or do I have to be louder here or wider here or this or that? If you're unsure, just go and release it. And the more you release, the better you will get. Don't overthink. And not every instrument is of the same importance. Turn it down if necessary. And remember, the mute button is the most important button you have as a mixer. If something is clashing, if you don't get it as clear as you want, mute things that are playing and see if it's going better. And get some multitracks and practice. Now, how do you go on from here? Upcoming events. I've come to an end. Hope that was okay for you. I had to postpone the other one because I wasn't finished with the preparation. And this is what I want to do for the next weeks. I want also concentrate more on making videos because not everybody has the time to watch a video for 1 hour and get all the information. For some topics, it's better to have 15, 20 minutes, everything in it. It's more work to do because I have to cut the video later here in this live. Okay, I have to prepare the things, but these are the things I do anyway. And then I do the live feed for 1 hour and that's it. So I don't care about if I say something wrong or whatever. I can correct it anytime. That's live. So what are the upcoming for videos? Best free FX plugin collections. I will recommend something for you, and not because I'm endorsing it or I get money for it, but because I use it and I find it useful. Then organizing your session. Cubase has a lot of subfolders in your arrangement folder and you can get lost very easy and can lose your whole arrangement. Then Cubase only will be a new episode, the new stereo delay that was in the new Cubase version. Then I will make one sound design, make a choir from your voice. There is this song from a band called 10cc. It's called I'm Not in Love. And that was in the day before we had samplers and whatever. And the three singers, Glenn Gould, no, it was Godley and Cream, and I think Glenn Gould, I think it was three singers. They recorded their voices on a 60-track machine, just singing, to make a choir. And then they recorded it on another machine by pushing the faders, the notes they needed for the chords. And I can show you how you can do that with your voice. And then I will be mixing Love in the City, the song with Cooper Moss vocals I played for you for the last two or three episodes. And I wanted to make some live streams every Saturday. I will make a speed mixing again, taking one of the beats. If you have an arrangement, if you have a song, and you want to have it mixed or you want me to do it, drop me a mail. Let me go here. Telefunken, where is it? Where is my mail address? You can see now right in the corner, harold@hiddenroom.de. Send me a mail or leave a comment. I check back to you. I can give you access to the Dropbox or to my web space so you can upload it. If you want to have a song and want me to mix it for free, nothing very special, just also do a live video, send it over, I'll make a mix for you. Then I will have the 60 minute or maybe it's 90 minute cover version challenge or cover song challenge. Some people ask me, can you make a complete song? Now, you cannot make a complete song in 1 hour or 1.5 hour. It takes 4 to 5 hours for recording and recording vocals, arranging it 8 hours. Then 4 to 5 hours mixing, depending on the genre. But what I want to do is I will use all the tricks I know with the chord track and with the chord pads and every other arpeggiator, whatever help you have in Cubase to make a cover version. You are, for example, working for the local theater. And the boss of the theater comes and says, oh, we need for the next performance, we need a cover version of this song. And you say, sure, I can make it. Oh, we have the sheet music, we have the chords, everything. Yes, I can make it. And yeah, but we need it tomorrow in the evening. So you have to work fast. So I will have three songbooks from some of my favorite bands. I don't tell you what bands these are right now. You will select one of the book and you will randomly, you, the audience, will randomly select one page, and I will do a cover version of this song that's on this page with a Cubase that's totally blank, starting from scratch. No track prepared, nothing. So the next one will also be next week Cubase only MIDI plugins. Then another one I have to prepare and I want to make, that's very exciting for me, mixing live drums without samples. Glenn Fricker from Spectre Sound Studios is always complaining that people are working with samples today too much, especially also in metal and in rock music, and all sound the same. And if you have a good drummer with a good sounding kit, you can make a unique sound. And this will make an episode, a live stream, mixing live drums. Maybe I will use one of the songs from the Telefunken or one of my songs. I will see what I do. But without samples and Cubase only. We'll mix the drums without samples and Cubase only. And because this also annoys me when I, for example, watch some of the videos and there are some people coming from audio schools, and yeah, especially guys coming from audio schools, and they mix a song, they get a song and have to mix them and show a video how they mix them. The first thing they do when they go to the drums, they grab four samples. And I always think they took a lot of effort to record the drums. Why not use it and make it unique? You can stand out with your own sound. And then working with spectrum analyzers. So I think this is it. This is also being a live stream because you can have a topic also for 1 hour. The next one, forget this one. Don't forget, you have time until the 17th of June. This is not an endorsement, and this is not paid, and this is not an advertisement. I own most of the stuff from Alcoy Multimedia, and I don't own this one. I have the Syntronic, the synthesizer, where you have all those Syntronic instruments, the Moog, Memory Moog, and Uno, and everything. And they give away the OXA, the Oberheim synthesizer, for free if you sign in for the newsletter. So go to the website, sign in for the newsletter, you will get the serial number you have to have, or you will make have to make an account on their website. So everything is there. If you already are a user of Alcoy Multimedia, you will have it anyway. If not, it's really worth it. Maybe tomorrow in the morning, if I have time, I will make a short video about the OBXA, because this is not just a sampler like the Halion, but it also is emulating the filters and everything. So you can use it like the original one. So go there. You have time until the 17th of June. So next time, 13th of June, 7:30 German time, I would have the MIDI plugins, arpeggiator, recorder, MIDI echo, step designer. I think I won't do, because this is also a topic for 1 hour. And I will make maybe a live recording of a song in 5 to 10 minutes without stopping Cubase, using all the tricks I have with the recorder, arpeggiator, and using the loop function, everything. So record something without Cubase. So thanks for being here. Thanks for watching me. Thank you, guys. I really appreciate it. And I know some of your names. And I really like it that you come back every Saturday and watch what I'm doing here. Really good, and I really like that, and give me the appreciation and also the drive to go on and to make more of that. Hope you liked it. So stay safe, take care, and stay healthy in these corona times. You never know what's going on, and have a nice weekend. Goodbye. Yeah, you can hear the kick.